me begin this presentation by appreciating the effort of the organizers of this Congress for deeming it fit to proceed with having this Congress as scheduled via this online platform. This is actually very important because it will not only give us the opportunity to make our presentations and exchange ideas, but more importantly, it will allow us to reach a wider audience. Our abstract was submitted and accepted under Section 8 of this Congress, titled Geoarchaeological and Environmental Assessment of Megalithic Mounds, Site Formation and Subsequent Modifications. Today, I will be presenting a paper titled Soil Micromorphology of the Sedimentary Samples from Megalithic Monument Antawan de Valdelage, Tomar, Portugal, as a case study. My name is Opayemi Adewumi. For the structure of this presentation, I've structured it in terms of introduction, the site, research questions, methodology, results, conclusions, and bibliographies. For the introduction, I'll be talking about soil micromorphology in geoarchaeological investigations, particularly focusing on megalithic monuments. On the site, I'll be talking about some of the site backgrounds, some of the information that we knew before in terms of site location, in terms of relevance and importance of the site. Research questions, what were the research questions that necessitated the application of micromorphology? And then on the methodology, I'll be explaining in details all the processes of the methodologies that we used from the field to the laboratory. And the results, I will be discussing some of the major results that we got from our analysis. And then we'll be talking about the discussions, the conclusions that we had, and then the bibliographies. Under the introduction, soil micromorphology is the study of undisturbed samples with the aid of microscope to determine, one, the composition of the constituents, and two, their spatial relationship. It is also aimed at deducing their genetic and chronological relationships. We also focus on three major things. One is sedimentary features, the second is pedological features, and the third is anthropogenic features. In all of these investigations reveal, in addition to macroscopic field evidence, indicators occur that are sometimes only visible under a microscope, thereby giving a complementary and holistic data presentation on the effect of land use change over a period of time. The site itself, Antawan de Valdelage, it is located in the municipality of Tomar, Santarém district, Portugal. It is one of the five Valdelage megalithic monuments. This is the only one that still exists today. It belongs to the METASH project, moving tasks across shapes, reassessing the mechanism of the agropastoralist spread in central Portugal. And over the years, a lot of excavations and analysis have been carried out on the site itself. There were two important phases of excavation, the first one between 1989 and 1991, that was coordinated by Professor Luis Osterbeck, and the recent one between 2017 and 2019, coordinated by Dr. Nelson Almelda and Professor Chris Carl, and of course, with Professor Luis Osterbeck. The site is positioned in a small elevation that dominates the landscape. The site is situated in a region of geomorphological diversity. It also belongs to the hydrographic system of Cesira River. Some of the importance of the site, it gives information about the landscape occupation strategies during the Holocene in the Middle Tagus. It also gives information about the agropastoralist spread from and into the Alto Ribatejo. From what we knew in terms of literature review about some of the research that has been done on the site in previous time, it was said that the megalithic monument was constructed during the early and middle Neolithic. But recent research has shown that it is actually between middle and late Neolithic from the materials that were studied. For the micromorphology application itself, we had few problem analyses. The first one has to do with stratigraphic sequence. There were issues of unclear modification succession. We had issues around human-induced landscape transformations. And then what micromorphology will be bringing on board in terms of contribution, it's stratigraphic faces identification. We'll be identifying the soil forming processes. We also know the construction phases of the monument, if they were constructed in a single period or in a period more than just one. The methodology itself, as you can see from this figure, there are five stratigraphic subdivisions, seven micromorphology blocks were taken from the site, and this is the process of of sampling, as you can see here, and then labeling the samples that will be taken, and then the process of covering the samples in order to allow easy extraction from the soil profile. And this samples were taken from three profile sessions, H, J, and F. The samples were processed at the geological laboratory of IPES in Tarragona in Spain. The thin section also, we processed the seven micromorphology blocks into 14 thin sections. And the analysis and the study was done using stereoscopic and petrographic microscopes of varying magnifications. The thin section description also followed Cotill, et al. And Stoops 2003. Also, we incorporated microfiltration analysis into this methodology. The essence of doing this is basically to identify if there were continuity or discontinuity in the faces of the profiles, as you could see on the microscope. So this allowed us to divide, based on what we saw on the microscope, to divide the layers in based on distinctions that we're able to see on the microscope. And then we have, for example, for samples that were taken in G and H, and G27 and H profiles were divided into several microfaces. And then we're able to analyze and see if there were distinct pedal features based on this classification. In terms of the presentation of the general characteristics of the result, we did the general characteristic description presentation of the result in the following, using microfaces, using grand mass. And basically under the grand mass, we had the fabric of coarse materials in random distribution, or sometimes it could be fine materials of undifferentiated porphyric. And then we had to identify the coarse fine ratio limit of 10 microns. Also, we have to know the ratio between the coarse material and the fine materials. Under the coarse component, we recognize quartz, ferromagnesian, feldspars, charcoal fragment, quartz, and sandstones in various proportions. Also, under the fine components, we had yellowish, brown, dotted, and speckled. We also had microstructure, which basically are either granular or moderately granular, as the case may be. Also, under the porosity, we had various examples of the porosity, so that the chambers, the channels, the planes. But the most important part of this result, well, those under the textural pedal feature session, where we had activities that we can actually give us, activities that actually occurred on the site based on the features that we recognize. These are the features that we're able to interpret and then makes us to have a sense of what actually happened on the site in years past. And so we had features such as silty clay coatings around sand grains. We had the infillings of silty clay with excremental fabrics. We had dusty clay coatings. We had limpy clay coatings, as the case may be. And this is just to give, this is just a table for one of the sample, or the thin section sample that was analyzed. And going to the microfaces classification, we classified the microfaces into three major groups, the sandy granular, as you can see. This picture or photo was taken from this region, from this path. And then we had the foggy or massive microstructure here, and then it was taken around this section. And then we had spongy microstructure, which is the third one. And this photo that you have here was taken from this part. In terms of pedal features that were recognized and some of the features that we could see on the picture, and we had the first one was silty clay coatings, as you can see with the red arrow showing the indication of the red arrow. But then there were also some bit of excremental fabric, as you can see here. And then we have the dense and complete infillings. We also had thin silty clay coatings, also with granular microstructure. We also had dusty clay coatings, and then we also have a presence of granular microstructure, microstructure, yes. And then we had cappings, of course, here, as you can see, of thin silty clay. Then we had the crescent-shaped clay coatings that are visible here. Then we had the micro-laminated silty clay. We had the limpid clay coatings. Also, we have the micro-laminated limpid clay coatings. And then what does all of this say to us in terms of the interpretation of the results and in terms of the analysis that was carried out? We sum this up in terms of site evolution, moment, period, and phases. So what we have is there were distinctions between phase one. Of course, there were some activities that actually spanned more than one phase, that extended to, from phase one to phase two and even phase three. But then there were actually basic distinctions that we were able to recognize. Also, in combination with the microphysics analysis that was done, we also incorporated Harris matrix in order for us to be able to arrange the stratigraphy and to order the stratigraphy in such a way that we'll be able to distinguish whether there was continuity in terms of stratigraphic layers or there was discontinuity in terms of stratigraphic layers. So starting from phase one, they were actually based on the Harris matrix and the similarities and differences that we saw from the features obtained on the thin section analysis that was done. We actually saw that there were some there were continuous agreement or congruence between the features that we see on a particular thin section and then the subsequent one, which was divided using the microphysics analysis. So we divided this based on the features that we saw into six working periods from A to F, and then these were grouped into phases beginning from phase one to phase three. And in phase one, some of the activities that we were able to recognize were vegetation cover. This was the initial occupation of the site, and this necessitated clearance. At this point, based on the pedal features that were recognized, it was characterized by vegetation clearance by burning. So in this phase also, there was the beginning of the construction of the monument, there was digging, there was soil burial, and of course, there were cultivation activities, or as we call it, arable activities. And then it moved to, there was stratigraphic continuity from here to the next level of phase two, and then the continuation of cultivation of arable activities. Then the construction of the monument ended in this phase two. Well, there were also features of physical disturbance, there were soil burial, there were collapse of the toe. And then one striking thing at this phase two was also the fact that there was a collapse of the monument, of the monument, which necessitated the abandonment. And this justifies what you have here of stratigraphic discontinuity, because the site was left abandoned and the site was left because it collapsed. And then there were other natural processes such as wedging. One fundamental question at this stage was what activity preceded what? Was it the collapse of the monument that led to the abandonment, or it was the abandonment that led to the collapse of the monument? This is actually one question that begs for answer in the future research that will be carried out on the site. And then we moved to the third phase, in which the site was reoccupied again. There was vegetation regrowth, there was clearance, vegetation clearance at this point by implement, unlike the first phase where it was characterized by burning. And then we had the monument construction, and then there were arable activities, and then weathering, natural process of weathering, and then leaching. For the conclusion, in all of this, we had the use of space and territory dynamics. And then we were able to classify this into four major conclusions. One has to do with agropastoralism. So there was a confirmation and endorsement of agropastoral spread in this region. The second has to do with human activities, particularly farming. We had sufficient evidence of clearance activities and even arable cultivation. And then we had the collapse of the tumuli and reoccupation. This was actually confirmed also by our studies. And of course, the reoccupation of the monument in phase three relates to mid-Bronze Age individual burials. And the last one has to do with the monument construction, where the construction took two phases of the site evolution. It's actually very important and interesting, some of the features that we're able to deduce applying micromorphology methodology to this kind of phenomenon, because megalithic monuments are something that are actually very important, and they are actually very widespread across the globe. And it's very interesting to study. It's an area of it's a monument that needs a lot of, of course, not just micromorphology, but a lot of many of the geological approaches to understand and to unravel, the mystery behind this kind of monument. They are also very important because they dot most of the landscape across the globe. These are the bibliographic references that we consulted. And finally, let me appreciate you for listening to this presentation and for watching as well. And in case you have any questions for me, please reach me via my email and I will be glad to respond to your questions. Thank you once again for your attention.